Examination of a thyroid lump, demonstrated by Dr. D.J. Anthony, Senior Lecturer, Department of Anatomy, Faculty of Medicine, University of Colombo. The thyroid gland is located in the anterior triangle of the neck, with its two lobes on either sides of the trachea connected by the isthmus. Before starting any clinical examination, one should introduce himself to the patient and obtain the appropriate consent. The privacy of the patient should be ensured. The examination room should be well lit. The patient should be positioned appropriately. Adequate exposure of the patient is essential, and there should be a chaperone.
Hi, I am Dr. D.J. Anthony. In this video clip, we are going to demonstrate the neck examination of a patient with a goiter. You can see the patient comfortably seated on a chair and the accompanying chaperone nearby. The other essential part is to obtain the consent. Mama Dr. D.J. Anthony, poddak me gediyet pariksha karala balanawa.
Basic steps of a thyroid lump examination. Inspection, palpation, percussion, auscultation, relevant general examination. The relevant general examination can be done at the beginning or at the end of the thyroid lump examination.
We will follow the order of inspection, palpation, percussion and auscultation. First of all, the inspection of the neck. It's always better for the examiner's eyes to be in level with the patient's neck. On inspection, there is a lump occupying the anterior triangle of the neck. The lump appears asymmetrical, more on the right side than the left side. And on the right side, there is a well-demarcated small nodule sitting on the enlarged lump. There are no scars visible in the neck. There are no visible pulsations. And the skin overlying the lumps is normal. There are no obvious dilated veins in the neck. We will get the patient to raise the hands to see whether the veins get distended when she raises her hands. Addeka uda tussanda tikak vela tiyan inda. Still, we can't see any dilated veins, which means the Pemberton sign is negative, which means there is no evidence of retrosternal extension on inspection. Now we will see whether this lump is arising from the thyroid gland. For that, I will give the patient a sip of water and ask her to swallow while inspecting the neck for upward movements of the lump. Me vathuru tika aragena kate thiyaganna gilinda epa man kiyenakal. Then gilinda. You could see very well the upward movement of the lump with swallowing, which suggests that the lump is arising from the thyroid gland.
Note whether the lump is located more towards the midline or laterally situated. A midline lump is more suggestive of a thyroglossal cyst. A thyroglossal cyst will move upwards with protrusion of the tongue. If it doesn't, it is more likely to be a thyroid lump. Smooth surface lump. Multinodular lump. Solitary nodule. In inspection, we look for overlying skin changes, surface of the goiter, symmetry or asymmetry of the swelling, pulsations, and movement with swallowing.
Now we will proceed with the palpation, and the palpation is done best from behind. It is important for the patient to flex the neck a little bit, not much, in order to relax the strap muscles so that we can feel the goiter easily. And make sure your thumbs are against the nape of the neck and your fingers coming forwards over the lump. I will palpate one side at a time. The lump appears to be it is a multinodular goiter, and with more nodules onto the right side than the left side. It's a non-tender lump with well-defined margins, and I can't feel any pulsations. The next step is to see whether I can get below the lump while she is swallowing. That is again to see whether there is retrosternal extension. මේ වතුර ටික කටේ තියාගන්න මං කියනකොට ගිලින්න ගිලින්න I can feel the lower borders very distinctly while she is swallowing. Therefore, there is no evidence of retrosternal extension on palpation. Now I will look for carotid pulses. Right side, it's not displaced. Left side, it's not displaced either. Then I will look for tracheal deviation. For which I will come from front. You can see the both heads of the sternocleidomastoid, and I will insert my finger into the suprasternal space and try to go between the trachea and the sternocleidomastoid head, and I can easily insert my finger on the right side, and on the left side it's difficult, which means there is evidence that the trachea is shifted to the left. Sometimes when the thyroid gland is much enlarged towards the isthmus, it's very difficult to do this maneuver. In that case, the alternative maneuver is to first feel for the laryngeal prominence, which can be easily felt, and then bring your finger down along the larynx and the trachea to see which way the trachea is going. And here you can see my finger is going towards, I can feel it almost to the left side, more towards the left side than the right side, which means the trachea is displaced to the left side.
In palpation, we feel for the surface, borders, consistency, and thrills over the goiter. Then we feel displacement of carotid pulses and trachea.
The next step of the examination is percussion. That is to see whether there is any evidence of retrosternal extension. It is important to percuss from resonant to dull. Therefore, I will percuss like this, resonant, resonant right throughout. It is resonant right throughout, which means there is no evidence of retrosternal extension on percussion. The final step of the examination is auscultation to look for a bruit. And I can't hear any bruits. Now I will palpate for enlarged lymph nodes. We will start with submental, which are not enlarged, then the submandibular. Then we'll proceed to upper deep cervical, then the lower deep cervical, supraclavicular, occipital lymph nodes, and the posterior auricular lymph nodes. None of the lymph nodes are enlarged. Thank you very much. So to summarize the examination findings, this is a multinodular goiter with more nodules on the right side than the left side, and the nodules are soft to firm in consistency and non-tender. There is no evidence of retrosternal extension, and the trachea is shifted to left, and there is no evidence of carotid pulse displacement, or there is no evidence of lymph node enlargements.
In the relevant general examination, we look for peripheral signs of thyroid status for thyrotoxicosis or hypothyroidism. Then we look for peripheral signs of metastatic malignancy. Following eye signs should be noted if present, which suggest thyrotoxicosis: lid lag and retraction, exophthalmos, proptosis, and ophthalmoplegia. Ask the patient to outstretch the hands and observe for fine tremors, which may be seen in thyrotoxicosis. Check for the radial pulses of the patient. Tachycardia and bounding pulses are seen in thyrotoxicosis. Examine the palms for moisture and warmth, which is also suggestive of thyrotoxicosis. If the patient has signs of myxedema, dry and cold palms, or delayed relaxation of deep tendon reflexes, hypothyroidism should be suspected. If carcinoma is suspected, look for signs of metastatic malignancy. Note any enlarged lymph nodes with hard consistency as noted before in the goiter examination. Palpate the entire skull for hard bony nodules, which is associated with follicular carcinoma. Look for any bony deformity or tenderness over long bones. Palpate the liver for any firm nodules and percuss the abdomen for free fluid. Percuss and auscultate over the lungs for signs of effusion and consolidation. If any of these are present, metastatic malignancy is highly suggested. Horner syndrome can be caused by either pressure exerted by a retrosternally extended goiter or by malignant infiltration of a thyroid carcinoma. The features of Horner syndrome are ptosis, enophthalmos, meiosis, and anhidrosis.